It's dawn on a Tuesday at Travis Air Force Base in Northern California. We're here as guests of the Air Force. They're sending a plane somewhere into the heart of the North Pacific to study a weather phenomenon called an atmospheric river. And we'll be riding shotgun.
Ahead if we have to disembark the plane when we crash in the water. Not that we will.
We're getting on that plane, which is a WC-130J Super Hercules with the Air Force, to meet an atmospheric river over the North Pacific. They're going to be dropping scientific instruments about halfway through to measure the atmospheric conditions in the storm.
Atmospheric rivers are the most important source of rain and snow in California, and they're responsible for the worst of its flooding. They're crucial to a region that's constantly teetering between not enough water and way too much. So scientists are anxious to understand and predict them. Which is why we're here, strapped into a cramped cargo plane, taking off on a 10-hour flight to nowhere, with no idea how far off script this flight was going to go.
We're just having a little bit of a system malfunction.
It's a potentially dangerous situation.
So sorry in advance, the audio is gonna suck. It is really, really loud in here. It's around 110 decibels, and it's impossible to hear anybody talk. So we've had to be a little scrappy with the audio.
The crew on this flight is all Air Force. The civilian scientists had to follow along from land. We met the pilot and the co-pilot, the navigator, the weather officer, and a cargo supervisor called the loadmaster. Both the crew and the aircraft are part of the vaunted Hurricane Hunters. These are the folks who fly directly into hurricanes to gather crucial weather data about the storms. Today's flight, much lower key. Our pilot walked us through the plan for the day.
So we took off from here at Travis Air Force Base, and so we're just flying out west. We're right here right now. This is where we're gonna start gathering data. And so they want data from here to here to here. So evidently that river is passing through here somewhere, I'm guessing.
While we do that, a twin flight will depart from Hawaii and cover the western end of the river.
So they're taking off from here and flying this route, and we're flying this route. And so as, you know, the storm must be coming across here, gathering as much data as we can from it.
As exciting as that sounds, the so-called river will be a little anticlimactic.
Will you know by a change in the weather, the conditions, or the turbulence at all when we've reached the atmospheric river, or is it?
We probably won't.
Okay.
It's just a matter of humidity in the air to us. It doesn't affect the airplane at all. So to us, it's kind of a non-event.
Scientists have been talking about atmospheric rivers since the 1990s, but they've hit headlines in a big way over the last few years.
An atmospheric river.
There is the atmospheric river.
It's an atmospheric river.
They're massive bands of moist air and wind that carry as much water as 27 Mississippi rivers. The ones in this region flow off the Pacific until they smack into a significant mountain range. That forces the air upward, where it cools and condenses to fall as rain and snow. Just a few of these storms can supply as much as half of California's yearly precipitation. And over the past 40 years, they've caused almost all of the estimated flood damage across large parts of the West Coast. But there's still a lot that scientists don't know about them. They can tell if there's going to be an atmospheric river, but anything more is tough, even just a few days out.
Basically, when, where, how long, how much? All of those things they want to be better at.
Anna Wilson is a weather researcher at UC San Diego and one of the people driving this mission from the ground.
Understanding them is really crucial for resilience of our water supply, for water managers and stuff, and also for emergency preparedness. And then, of course, there's like the everyday reason that people just want an accurate weather forecast.
Today's mission exists because Anna and others need a detailed picture of atmospheric rivers. And the data need to be sampled vertically, all the way down to the ocean surface. Satellites can struggle to see the action through the clouds. But luckily, there's another tool called a drop sonde. It's a little airborne lab that parachutes down to the ocean surface, collecting data along the way. We've got a few boxes of them on board. When the time comes, the loadmaster will fire about 25 out the bottom of the plane. We spoke to the navigator about the route.
I'm going to build waypoints for us to fly and that equal spacing. The range rate crosses our line. That's what we're going to be dropping.
With the plan in place, we settled in to wait for our rendezvous with the river. Except that never happened. A couple hours into the flight, the crew got a lot busier, conferring with each other and looking out at the wing of the plane. And then, abruptly, word came down. We were heading back to base immediately. We asked the loadmaster what was happening.
What's going on right now?
We're experiencing a fuel system malfunction.
What does that mean?
That means that we are losing fuel every single time that we transfer fuel between tanks. We're turning around to go home. We've terminated mission.
We eventually got the full story from the pilot.
So we have 8 fuel tanks. 2 of those extra tanks we used on our way out here, and they worked fine. The last 2 fuel tanks we tried to use when it became time for those, we can see a fuel leak when we use those other 2 extra fuel tanks.
Leaking. How can you tell there's a fuel leak?
Because you see the fuel, streaming down the right wing as it goes behind the airplane.
2 unusable tanks meant enough fuel to get home, but not enough to reach the atmospheric river and get home.
How's that feel?
Terrible. It's showing up for a sporting event, hearing that your team is forfeiting, you know? It's just, we don't like to do it.
Word of the mission failure reached the scientists on the ground, too.
I was right here in this office, and the reaction was disappointment, but also just like, oh, you know, what's the problem? Make sure they can get back okay and everybody will be safe. And you're all the way out in the middle of the Pacific. That's nerve-wracking.
Still, it's a bummer, because understanding atmospheric rivers is only getting more critical. California's rainfall already fluctuates wildly from year to year. And as climate change continues, scientists are predicting the worst of both worlds.
The stronger storms will get stronger and more intense and longer, and the lower category storms or precipitation that isn't from ARs is expected to decrease in frequency. We can just expect that to increase with extremely wet years, flipping back and forth with extremely dry years.
The end of the mission went by fast. The plane made a beeline back to base. The loadmaster did fire off a couple dropsondes, but it was mostly for our benefit. And just like that, we were back over land. So, obviously, a disappointing flight. But one silver lining, remember that second flight from Hawaii? It was successful. It sent 25 dropsondes into the river. The data from the sensors made it back to the plane, then up to a satellite, then out to databases around the world. And from there, it helps make real predictions about the river. Which is no joke. We later saw some of the damage caused by this specific atmospheric river. It went on to flood the town of Sumas, Washington, and cause a landslide across Interstate 5 near Seattle. So these flights, they matter. And with more extreme weather in the forecast, scientists like Anna will take all the data they can get.
We were glad to at least have the Hawaii flight. Of course, it would have been better if this plane could have done all of the observations, but we'll still appreciate what we've got and then just keep planning for success in the future.
This video is a collaboration between The Verge and CalMatters, a nonprofit news outlet bringing you stories about policy and politics in California. For more on atmospheric rivers, head over to calmatters.org, where we have a much longer story. And thanks for watching.